In the years following his time as a rock superstar, Michael Bloomfield lived quietly in Mill Valley, sharing his days with friends and family, and pursuing in his own way the music he deeply loved. That music was blues, ragtime, jazz, gospel, and country, genres squarely in the American tradition. He worked to fulfill his obligation to Columbia for two more albums by recording a live jam session at the Fillmore West over two weekends in the winter of 1969. A loose-knit group of Mike's friends and former bandmates was similar in structure to the Electric Flag. One new member was drummer Bob Jones.
I think, you know, Michael has the place pretty much mesmerized, from what I remember. And, you know, there's that one intro that's so totally Michael, you know, where he gets started and then people aren't ready. So he just stops, and he's just clapping along. And he waits, and then he starts it again, and this time everyone's ready. That's like so him. You know, he didn't care. I don't know, he wasn't much for putting on airs, you know, it was just very real. I think he was extremely frustrated with Columbia, and he looked at this as the easiest way to fulfill his album commitment under his contract. I think he had done all of his fighting he was going to do about the flag.
Michael also completed his first solo album, a deeply personal testament called, ironically, It's Not Killing Me. It would be his last major label release. The decade of the 70s dawned with Bloomfield working in local clubs, often with former bandmates. Their casual affiliation would frequently be billed as Michael Bloomfield and Friends. Mike's playing had never been better. By the mid-70s, however, the IRS had come knocking, demanding payment of taxes owed from Bloomfield's days with the Electric Flag. Need for cash drove Michael to reluctantly agree to several supergroup schemes. The Electric Flag was briefly reunited, issuing one record before disbanding once again in the winter of 1974. Michael also joined old friend John Hammond in the studio for a recording called Triumvirate. I want you to rock me, baby, just like my back ain't got no bone. But it was an aborted supergroup project called KGB that inspired Michael Bloomfield to create what many consider to be one of the best recordings of his career. Disgusted once again by the hype and artificiality of the commercial music industry, Bloomfield arranged with Guitar Player magazine to create a tribute to those musicians who inspired him. It would be a recording that would also serve as a guide for young players wishing to learn about the blues. The album, called If You Love These Blues, Play 'Em As You Please, covered a wide range of styles from electric to acoustic. An instruction booklet was included, and each tune was given a brief introduction.
Thrift Shop Rag is a fingerpick rag in the key of C, using a Gibson acoustic guitar, no thumb picks, no finger picks.
Mm-hmm. resulting album was so well received it was nominated for a Grammy Award.
I think on record, my most rewarding guitar work was on an album called If You Love These Blues, Play Them As You Please. It was a Grammy nomination, and for me on record, that's it. That's as best as I've ever played on record.
The Altar Song, the tune that closed the album, was an unabashed tribute by Michael to all those who had been important in his musical life. It was a touching homage and quintessential Bloomfield.
At this time, I'd like to thank B.B. King, Freddie King, Albert King, Eddie King, Al King, Robert King, Otis Rush, Robert Johnson, Magic Sam, Lonnie Johnson, Blind Blake, Muddy Waters, Willie McTell, John Lee Hooker, T-Bone Walker, Earl Hooker, Lightning Hopkins, Howlin' Wolf, Robert Nighthawk, Johnny Otis, Shuggy Otis, Jimmy Rogers, Chicago Jimmy Rogers, Roy Buchanan, Wayne Bennett, Jeff Beck, Matt Murphy, Mick Taylor, Jimmy Nolan, Eric Clapton, Little Beaver, Peter Green, Papoose, Paul Butterfield, Chuck Berry, Mel Brown, Kenny Burrell, Wes Montgomery, Charlie Christian, Eddie Lang, Teddy Bunn.
As the 70s waned, Mike Bloomfield continued to explore the roots of American music. With his friend Norman Dayron, he produced a number of albums for small labels like Tacoma and Kicking Mule. The music ranged in style from electric and acoustic blues to traditional ragtime and jazz. One of those recordings featured Michael and guitarist Woody Harris performing gospel and spiritual pieces together. The black gospel tradition had always deeply affected Michael, and now he concentrated on it both on record and in performance. In November 1980, Mike Bloomfield received a visit from an old friend at his Reed Street home in Mill Valley. Bob Dylan was in San Francisco for a series of concerts, and it had been a long time since he'd seen Michael. While there, he invited Bloomfield to come sit in at the Warfield Theater where he was performing. Michael, though touched by the gesture, was unsure at first whether he would join Bob on stage. But in an extraordinary musical moment, Bob Dylan and Michael Bloomfield recreated Like a Rolling Stone, the tune they had recorded 15 years earlier, launching a new era in popular music and culture. It would be a fitting finale to Mike Bloomfield's remarkable career.
All right. I was playing in a club in Chicago, and I guess it was about 1959 or 1960. And I was sitting in a restaurant, I think it was probably across the street, or maybe it wasn't even part of the club, I'm not sure. But a guy came down and said that he played guitar. So he had his guitar with him, and he began to play. I said, well, what can you play? And he played all kinds of things. I don't know if you ever heard of a man, is it Big Bill Brunzy, ring a bell? Or Sonny Boy Williams and that type of thing. Anyway, he just played circles around anything I could play. And I always remember that. Anyway, we were back in New York, I think it was about 1963 or 1964. I needed a guitar player on a session there I was doing. And I called up, I even remembered his name. And he came in and recorded an album. At that time, he was working in a Paul Butterfield Blues Band. Anyway, he played with me on a record, and I think we played some other dates, but I haven't seen him too much since then. Anyway, he played on Like a Rolling Stone. here tonight, give him a hand, Michael Bloomfield. Once upon a time you dressed so fine, to the bumps of dime in your prime. People thought you'd be way down, you're buying the fun you thought they were all. Kidding you, you used to laugh about.
Months later, on February 15, 1981, Michael Bloomfield was found in his car, dead of an overdose of drugs. It was the end of an era. The man who had brought blues into the mainstream, who had taught us all about the roots of American music, and had pointed the way for a generation of rock musicians, was gone. But whenever anyone picks a guitar and works to make a sound that is truly his own, Michael Bloomfield is there. Anytime anyone digs into the roots of their music and discovers its extraordinary history and love, Michael is there too. And whenever anyone finds real fulfillment in music of any sort, they are following in the footsteps of Michael Bloomfield. That was Mike Bloomfield's gift to us all.
Thank you.